Something like this? You can never explain something like this. And if you were able to, the odds are you wouldn't much care for the answer.
Sinister has accomplished something only a few films have ever achieved. Scaring the living shit out of me. Since my first time seeing it back in 2012 to rewatching it for the dozenth time 7 years later, it still holds the title of the scariest movie I've ever seen. So, what makes Sinister so terrifying? When I first sat down to really analyze Sinister, I started taking notes on what moments in the film were scary, and I noticed a few things. First being, Sinister received an R rating from the MPAA, these guys, which definitely isn't uncommon in the horror genre, but when I was studying the movie, I noticed something unique. There's no nudity, and there's no sexual scenes at all. There's apparently 2 F-bombs in the movie, but after a dozen watches, I have yet to hear them. And there's not really any gore in this film. You might remember the movie being gory, but seriously, there's only a couple scenes where blood is present, lasting no more than 2 minutes. So why did it earn itself an R rating, if there's no nudity, no sex, no profanity, and no real gore? The MPAA rating states, rated R for disturbing violent images and some terror. This film has its fair share of horror tropes. There are 7 jump scares, there's a 4-minute sequence using the classic "the audience sees danger when the character doesn't" trope. There's the use of the classic shot reverse shot trope when we were first introduced to the ghost kids. And then there are some cheap scares in the subplot of Trevor having these night terrors. It's possible this film is scary because it has a good amount of cheap scare tactics. So I put this theory to the test and edited a version of Sinister without these scenes. I deleted more than 24 minutes of footage and removed all but 1 jump scare. The only jump scare that remains is in the lawn work home movie. And I kept that in the edit because the home movies are evidence in these unsolved murder cases. Honestly, I was surprised with what I discovered. The edit without the scare tactics is far more terrifying than the version with the scare tactics. So I'm going to analyze what is left of the movie and try to uncover what makes Sinister more terrifying when you remove these scare tactics.
Every minute that we're here, we're a minute closer to that happy ending that we always dreamed of. We're almost there.
When I cut out the horror tropes, the focus of the film is Ellison investigating these crimes and the sacrifices he makes for this new book. Success and happiness obviously looks different for everyone, but society has definitely taught us that sacrifice is one of the keys to finding success. Andrew Neiman in Whiplash sacrifices a whole lot in his pursuit of becoming one of the greats. Clarice Starling's sacrifice in Silence of the Lambs is seeking help from Hannibal Lecter to catch a crazy serial killer and live up to her reputation. And Ellison's sacrifice is his family's safety in this pursuit of another hit novel. This pursuit of success is all around us. It's quite common on YouTube and has led to YouTubers making some extremely poor decisions. But as we've seen with other examples of obsession, there's consequences to these sacrifices. And you only see these consequences when the blindfold is removed. And we can see that Ellison has his blindfold tied nice and tight.
Do you understand what you've done this time? The kind of jeopardy you've put your children in? Your marriage?
Yes, I do! I understand!
You won't do for your goddamn book!
The scene isn't jump out of your seat scary, but it is scary because we see the dangers that Ellison doesn't. True crime stories have been striking fear in people's hearts since the dawn of the horror genre. It's another part of why Silence of the Lambs is so brilliant. People love to play a good game of Clue, and Sinister is no exception. But the clues found in this film are outright heinous. Watching the home movies that Ellison finds is definitely one of the most terrifying parts of Sinister. But just as Ellison obsesses over the mystery, it's easy for us to obsess over it as well. Who made these films? Where did the box of home movies come from? Who is Bagul? There's a level of realism that comes from true crime plots, and these Super 8 films, the realism in it is just uncanny. One thing that loses me a lot of times in horror films is when they break reality and try to scare with visual effects. However, there are no visual effects in these Super 8 films. Director Scott Derrickson even said that all these scenes are real. They really hung these people, and even due to a mishap, they had to fire one of the stunt coordinators because he almost hung one of the actors. They actually pulled this family into the water, and the ghoul is standing at the bottom of the pool. Along with the realism of the Super 8 movies, Sinister does a fantastic job putting us in Ellison's shoes by making the movie visually dark. Because for the week Ellison is living in this new home, he locks himself up and is living in the dark. And that's just a recipe to drive someone mad. 75% of the film takes place inside the new home, and all the scenes that just played are set in the middle of the day. Sinister never gives the viewer the relief and safety by being in the light. It's like we're living in this nightmare with Ellison, and I think this technique really brings us closer to Ellison's process for solving these open murder cases. These ideas show that with the horror tropes removed, that the film becomes focused on this pursuit of success and the mystery of these crimes that brought Ellison to the house in the first place. But what I think really makes the movie so damn scary is not what I expected. I wasn't totally sure of this theory when I first uncovered it, but I think it's the main reason why Sinister is so good at creating fear. When Sinister starts, we are introduced to the plot by watching the Super 8 film of family hanging out, but I don't think anyone was immediately terrified watching this. Maybe more unsettled and disturbed, but now let's watch that scene again, this time when Ellison watches it. Way more impactful than us merely just watching it. The whole film is pretty meta when you think about it. It's basically the viewer watching Ellison watch these horror films. And now that I called it out, it's like, duh, of course it's more impactful. Watching Ellison watch these Super 8 films comes with so much more context. How he found them in the attic, how his family doesn't know he's in the house of an open murder case, and how Ellison has this evidence that the police doesn't. And he's trying to uncover the serial killer behind these films. But I want to illustrate my point by looking at a classic scene in horror that you'll probably recognize. Watching someone watch horror can feel like watching ourselves watch horror. If you're anything like me, you've probably stayed up a bit too late watching scary movies in the dark. You've probably been home alone and heard a noise and grabbed a knife to go investigate. So watching Ellison is like watching ourselves. And when Ellison, this fearless true crime author, becomes truly terrified to the point of packing up and leaving in the middle of the night, it makes it all the more real.
We have to leave now.
Oh, you're freaking me out here.
Get the kids, pack the car. We have to leave. Go!
So why does editing out all the horror tropes make the film scarier? Because these scary scenes remind us that it's a horror movie. The moment it happens, it breaks reality and the link between us and Ellison. In the commentary with Scott and Cargill, they even commented that this was their intention with the jump scare at the end of the movie. The point was to remind us that it's just a horror film, but I think all the scenes I cut out serve that same reminder. And that leads me to my biggest question of the film. Why make a movie less scary? Because this new version is definitely more terrifying. Maybe they added these scenes to fill time, or maybe Scott and Cargill decided it'd be going too far. Because even with the scare tactics, for the last 7 years, Sinister has held the title of the scariest movie I've ever seen. There's a lot to learn from Sinister. It demonstrates that using horror tropes doesn't make a movie any scarier. Sinister also creates fear by having the audience watch someone watch horror films. Add that to the fact that Bagul lives within these films and watching the home movies allows him into your life, well, that'd make me want to sleep with the lights on. Let me know what you think. Thanks for watching. This is my first video essay, so if you want to see more videos like this, please subscribe and give this video a like. Also, let me know in the comments, what's the scariest movie you've ever seen?